Following on from last week, I wanted to talk a little bit more about collection performance. Now, worrying about performance in any area is a rabbit hole down which you do not want to go too deep, because you'll just start worrying about the tiniest detail. But I think in this case, there is one other area with collections that's worth looking at, which is the performance relationship between an array and a list, the two basic collections that we probably use most commonly in .NET. And so I've put together some benchmarking to show you what I'm talking about here. So here we've got a couple of collections. We've got a list of int that just has 10 elements, 0 through to 9, and an array of ints with the same contents. And then my two benchmarks so far, I am simply looping through them in a for loop, 0 through to 9. We've hard-coded the 10, so there's no issue about count like we had last time. And then I'm just using the indexer to increment each one of those values. So that's going to do both a get operation on that particular element of die and a set operation. And then if we go to main, we'll see I'm simply benchmarking those. So let's run that up. And as ever, let's whiz through because it'll take a little while to do this. And what we can see here is that our array, which was the baseline, has the ratio of 1. And then we can see a list doing that was quite a bit slower. So we've got 1.61 as opposed to 1 for looping through and doing the read and the write. And once again, to understand the reason behind that, we need to understand the underlying structure of lists and arrays. So last time, as I was explaining, we saw that with a list, you have hidden inside it an array which is larger than the current size of the list. And then when we push things into the list, we just keep adding on to the end of that array until we hit the limit, at which point we do a reallocation, a larger array is allocated, the data is copied over, the old one is got rid of, and then we just carry on. So that's the list. But with an array, it's much simpler because we just have the array. There's no ability whatsoever to add new elements into an array or to remove them. You can modify them, but you can't change the number of elements. And so it's pretty simple. And so with an array, we have this value of length, which is the number of elements in the array. But with a list, we have a couple of values. We have count, which is the number of elements actually in use in the list. And then we also have what the list calls capacity, which is actually the length of the underlying array, so the amount you can fill it up to before you're going to need this kind of reallocation. Now, when we access an element inside an array, something that's absolutely fundamental to the way that .NET works is it has to do bounds checking. It has to make sure that the index of the element you've asked for is within the bounds of the array. And this is something that languages like C++ and C don't do. They assume that the programmer knows what they're doing and will never access out of the bounds of the array. So if we asked for, say, the 50th element in an array that only contained 30 elements, then it would simply offset from the beginning by 50 places and access whatever memory was there. And if you're lucky, then that memory will not be allocated to your program and the application will simply terminate, it will crash. If you're unlucky, however, that memory will be allocated to your program, but for some completely different variable. And if you read it, or even worse, if you write it, you'll modify that variable without knowing you've done it, and your data will be corrupt. And that's a much nastier problem to try and solve. Also, this sort of thing can be exploited by hackers and virus writers. If they know what's actually at that memory location beyond the end of your array, they can deliberately access it and cause trouble. And so that's why it's an absolute no-no in .NET. When you access an array, the system will check that you are within the bounds of the array. And the same also applies to a list. So when you access an element in a list, it will firstly check to see that you are within the count for that list, so the number of actually allocated elements. And then once it does that, it will then, presuming that's safe, it will then access the underlying array, but the array has to check again. The array has to do this fundamental validation to make sure you're within the bounds, because the list is just a .NET C# class. It has no special status, and it cannot say to the array, don't worry about checking, I've already done it. The array has to do the check. And that means that whenever you access an element in a list, you are checking twice. Just like Santa Claus with his list, you're checking twice to check both that you're within the count and that you're within the length. And that is really the most fundamental reason why lists are going to be slower than arrays for this sort of thing. And in fact, if we look at the source code for a list, we can see exactly what's happening. So here we've got on GitHub, here we've got our list in there, the generic for T, and we can immediately see some of the things I'm talking about. So there is our underlying array of items. And then if we go down here a little bit, we can see, for example, the capacity is the length of that underlying array. If we go a little bit further, here we can see the indexer, and this is what's happening in the benchmark I was showing you, because the list has to check to make sure we're within the size, that's its internal term for the count, and then once it's done that, it indexes into the array, which has to do its own fundamental check that you can't bypass. So you can see immediately why it's going to be slower to do the indexing on the list than it is the indexing on the array. Now that might make you just think, well, why don't we use arrays because they're more efficient? But then of course we hit the basic problem with an array. As we've said, you cannot expand it or reduce it. It's the size that you initially declare it to be. And it is extremely rare in my experience in any program that you actually want that you know in advance how many elements you're going to have in your collection. If you've got a payroll of employees, you keep on adding employees, it goes up. If you've got an airspace of aircraft, then you're going to add new ones, remove them, that sort of thing. If you've got space invaders in a game, you don't know how many they're going to be. You're going to add them, you're going to remove them, and all that sort of thing. So because of the ability of a list to expand to fit, that's why lists tend to be favored, even though they have this performance deficit. But actually, it's a bit more complicated than that, because if you look at how many programs work with collections, you can actually divide them into two phases. There is a population phase, which is where you are doing the add to the list and making it expand to fit. But then very often, once you've populated it, then the population remains the same and you start processing the list without any alterations to it whatsoever. So if we were doing some kind of scientific analysis, we'd add a data point, we'd add a data point, we'd add a data point. But once we've reached the situation where we've got all our data, then we're not going to add any more. We're going to do lots and lots of processing. So there is an argument that actually it could be better if we start out with a list, populate the list, and then convert it to the array when we're going to start doing the processing. Now that's particularly true if you're dealing with iQueryable. So if we just in here were to put in some function that took an iQueryable of, let's say, string, then you've got a couple of extension methods on there that are very important. You've got a toList and you've got a toArray. And what both of those do, if your iQueryable is connected to a data source in something like linked to entity framework, then doing toArray or toList will actually force the execution of the query. And so it's something you kind of want to try to avoid. You want to leave it till the last minute. But when you do finally do it, in most cases, it's going to be better to do the toArray. It's very rare, if ever, that you will pull in your collection from the database and then want to start adding to that collection, which is what you could do with a toList. So converting it with a toArray is going to be just as easy and will be this little bit quicker, as we've seen in those examples there. So as I say, you don't want to worry too much about performance until it hits you as a problem. But as a good habit, I think calling toArray rather than toList in this sort of situation with the iQueryable is certainly good practice. But it also can be quite a good idea even if we're dealing with actual in-memory data. So if we go back to our benchmarks, what I'll do here, I will comment out the ones we were dealing with there, and let's pop in some additional ones. And what I've now done, I've popped in a constructor, which is now making both the list and the array rather bigger. We've got 10,000 elements in there, just 0 through to 9999, and then in all three of these benchmarks, I am simply adding up all of those items. And I'm doing that with an array.sum or a list.sum. And the sum extension method isn't one that you really need to worry about in terms of performance, like the ones we looked at last week, but it just loops through and is going to add up all the elements. So ultimately, sum is going to call the getEnumerator. So if we just take another look at the source code and just find the enumerator for this. So here's our enumerator for the list, and here is our move next. And once again, we can see we've got the same issue because we firstly check against the size, that's the count, remember, and then if it passes that one, we do the index into the underlying array, and that is going to have to check again. So even if we're doing anything through the enumerator, we've still got this double check that we've got to watch out for. And so that's going to happen within the sum. So I do that for the array, I do it for the list, and then something that is going to be a trade-off, I convert the list into an array and then do the sum there. So the trade-off is, in terms of the looping through when it does the sum, that's going to be higher performance because it doesn't have to do the check twice. But obviously you've got the overhead of the two array, which is going to have to do a copy of all the data to take it out of the list and put it into the array. So how does that trade-off work? Well, let's take a look by running that one now. Again, let's race to the end. And there we can see that in this case, the trade-off has worked in our favor. So our array is the baseline, has a ratio of one. That's clearly the fastest because it's not got this double checking. The list is slower because it's had to check both the count and the length. But then on the two array, we can see that it's not quite as fast as the array because it's had to pay the overhead of doing the conversion, but it is even just in this case of 10,000 elements, quite a bit more efficient than doing the sum directly on the list. So it's not going to always be like that, but we can certainly see there will be times when you get the benefit. So really, we can summarize all that into three basic rules. If you can use an array, if you don't need to be adding elements or removing elements at all, then just use an array. That's going to be most efficient. If you are using an iQueryable connecting to an external data source through something like Entity Framework, then it's better to do the two array if you're going to force the execution under the assumption you don't need to add anything to it. And then even if you do need to add two things, if you have this approach of there being a population phase and then a processing phase, if you're getting performance issues, then do consider the use of actually converting your list to an array once it's populated, and then you can process it much faster. Okay, so that's it. I don't think I'm going to do many more videos on collection performance unless something comes up that someone suggests. But if you like that, do click like, do subscribe, and I'll see you next time.